Welcome back. Today we're going to learn about the next step in glazing. So we already talked about underglaze. That's the, you know, basically a colored clay that you paint onto your piece. And today we're going to talk about overglaze. And overglaze is a very different beast. Underglaze, as we talked about, looks the color that it's going to be once it's fired. It's a matte finish and it's opaque. Overglaze, however, undergoes a chemical reaction in the kiln and transforms from a liquid, or a solid suspended in liquid technically, into a liquid on the surface of your piece, and then it solidifies back into a solid as it cools down. And it undergoes a chemical transformation. So there's some things to be aware of with overglaze. Overglaze does not look the color it's going to be in the bottle. This Duncan Artisan glaze is a beautiful light green with kind of some varied lighter green colors on the top when it's fired. But if you look at the bottle, can you see that it's red? I'll open it up. It's kind of a pinkish red color when you paint it on. So you need to understand with overglaze that you do not go by the color in the bottle. You need to look at, if you're in my classroom, I have a chart on the wall with little tiles that show what it looks like. If you're not with me, you can always look it up online too. Duncan Artisan Glaze, Marbled Celadon. Look it up, see what it looks like once it's fired, okay? So it undergoes a chemical reaction in the kiln, changes color. The other thing to be aware of with overglaze is it's translucent or transparent, meaning that you can either see through it completely or partly. So if we look at this little guy, he's been overglazed. You can see the clay through the glaze. It settles into the cracks and crevices. So it's beautiful to use when you're highlighting textures or you want to have varied effects on the surface of your piece. It also means that if you're using more than one color and you're overlapping them, you're going to see the original color behind. So you can't paint one on top of the other without them interacting in the kiln and seeing that crossover. The other thing to note with overglaze is you can't mix them in a predictable manner. If I took a blue overglaze and mix it with a yellow overglaze, I might not get green. I might get brown. I might get a darker blue. I might get olive green. I don't know what I'm going to get because the color is the result of a chemical reaction in the heat of the kiln. It is not a result of the basic colors mixing. So I would not suggest mixing overglaze colors unless you really want to experiment and just see what happens. If you're up for that, try it. But if you want a predictable outcome, just use the color in the bottle as is. Don't mix it with other things. So it's translucent. It undergoes a chemical reaction in the kiln. It is shiny. And you can see through it when you layer things up.
So let's talk setup first and getting started. Anytime I glaze, I have a paper towel that I keep underneath my work. Helps me to keep my table cleaned up. I have an extra paper towel that I use to dry brushes, clean up messes. I have a clean bin of water and whatever brushes that I need. If I'm doing a single color glaze on something, I'll use a big brush. If I'm doing some detail work, I'll also have some smaller brushes to get into details. You want to use, in general, with clay, a stiffer bristled brush so that you can really get into cracks and crevices. I also have my glaze ready to go. This is a Amoco opalescent glaze. I chose it for this piece, which I already have a coat of glaze on. And this is just an all-over glaze. I selected it because I liked how the texture really pops out on this one. And I have these waves that I carved into this piece that I want to be visible. So I picked a glaze purposely to highlight that texture. For this piece, I'm going to use a type of glaze that I usually warn my students away from on a lot of their work, because a lot of the work that we do, we focus on textures and details, and these types of glazes tend to obliterate those textures and details. It's a crystals glaze. So if you look at the bottom of this jar, you can see there's little pieces of what look like glass, and that's exactly what it is, little pieces of glass that would float into the glaze once I have it stirred up. And those pieces of glass get applied to the outside of this, like little chunks. And when this heats up and the glaze melts in the kiln, those chunks kind of bloom out, almost like a bloom in watercolor. and it'll leave kind of spots on the piece, which can look really beautiful. However, if you have a lot of texture, those spots detract from it, you don't see it. I tend to use crystals on pretty simple pieces. This is a simple wheel throwing bowl. I'm not super hyped about the details that I put into it, so I'm gonna use that crystals glaze on it. I think it will look nice. I would never use a crystals glaze on something like this that has a lot of card detail into it, as it would detract. Or a piece like this that has really subtle texture that I wanna highlight, if I put a crystals glaze on this, it's gonna take away from it. When you're ready to glaze, before you get started, the first thing you need to do is shake up your bin of glaze. One thing you really want to be careful of when you shake the bin is you always want to have your fingers on the top of the lid to hold it on and then shake it up really good. I have had every year students come in, they don't put their hands there, and whoever used this glaze before them did not close that lid tight. The lid flies off when they shake up the glaze, and glaze gets everywhere. It's a mess. So always hold that lid tight. On a crystals glaze, I can shake like this, but those crystals aren't going to get into the mix, so I'm going to have to stir it up with the handle of one of my brushes.
Sometimes you have to stir thicker glazes too.
I've got my glaze stirred up, and I'm ready to get started. With any glaze, you are going to put 2 to 3 coats depending on how thick the glaze is. This is a pretty thick glaze, so I think I can get away with 2 coats. So I'm going to brush the first coat on. With a crystals glaze, typically on the second coat, you kind of place your crystals on the piece in specific areas. So the first coat, I just want to make sure I have good and full coverage on my piece. With overglaze, which is what we're using today, we want to avoid glazing the bottoms of our vessels, because when this sits in the shelf to get fired, that bottom of the vessel touches the kiln shelf, and when the kiln gets hot enough, this glaze is a mixture of silica, basically the same types of things that you would find in glass. And when it gets hot enough, the solid components in this melt and fuse and become basically a glass that covers the coating of your piece. And then when the kiln cools down, those compounds solidify into that solid glass. And if there's any glaze on the bottom of this, that glass will stick to the kiln shelf, and the only way you're going to get your piece off the kiln shelf is to break it off. So you want to make sure that you avoid glazing the bottom of your vessel or any place on a piece of sculpture that would touch the kiln shelf. When you're glazing, your brush stroke is important, because sometimes, especially in smooth flat areas like I have on the inside of my vessel here, sometimes the brush stroke is visible in the end. So when I do coats on my pieces when I'm glazing, I either make sure that I use the brush stroke all flowing in one direction carefully in case it's seen, or I'll brush it in one direction on one coat and the opposite direction on the second coat, just to give a little variation so the brush stroke is less visible. I'm gonna let this set up for a few minutes. I'm gonna rinse my brush out. I'm gonna put a second coat on in a little bit. All right, my first layer is set up. So now I'm going to come in with my second layer, and I want to show you something. Do you guys see this little spot here that I missed on that first layer? It's really important when you're glazing that you're picking up your piece and that you're looking at it from all sorts of different angles, because otherwise this kind of stuff happens. And when this gets fired, I mean, it's obvious right now, it'll be even more obvious when it's fired. So as I come into my second layer, the first thing I'm going to do is touch up that spot and then make sure to get a second coat on it. With regular glaze, the second layer, I'm just thinking about my brush strokes. I'm making sure that I've got even coverage, and working towards making sure that everything has a nice, even, purposeful finish. With the crystals glazes, if you happen to be using those, and again, I caution my students to use this on any piece that has a lot of texture or detail, because it will kind of cover that up. But with crystals glazes, in addition to making sure you have good coverage, you want to make sure these are the crystals, those little lumps and bumps that you can see on the surface. You want to make sure that you have pretty even coverage of those little lumps and bumps, those little crystals.
Make sure your second coat's just as thorough as your first.
I'm going to let this dry, and then my last step is going to be cleaning up that bottom and getting it ready for the kiln. On this piece, I've got two coats already on the outside. I've taken my time, done a nice job. I've got a little bit of a messy base that I'm gonna have to clean up. But how do I glaze the inside of a vessel like this? I can get a brush in and do these edges. I can get a brush in and do the bottom, but I can't get the rest of it glazed. Here is your answer. You are going to pour your glaze in and run it around the inside, and then you're gonna dump it out. So for that, I'm gonna use a glaze. This one's got a little bit of a liquidiness to it. I'm gonna open it up here, and I'm going to pour it in. Typically, I would do this before I glaze the outside, so if a little bit of it, whoops, spills on the outside, I can clean it up. I guess I'm gonna do some experimenting on this piece. All right, I'll talk about what to do with that afterwards here. All right, I dumped a whole bunch of glaze onto the inside of this piece and accidentally on the outside, and I'm just gonna kind of rotate it around to get good coverage.
You're rotating around and ensuring the glaze covers the entire inside.
Okay, so I've rotated it around all throughout that inside, and now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna bring this over and I'm gonna rotate it around and dump it back into my vessel.
I'm just rotating here to make sure that the mouth of the vessel is fully covered. Get all that glaze out. Spend some time dumping it back in. Glaze is pretty expensive. Don't waste any.
All right. I've got the entire inside glazed. And I've taught you a valuable lesson with my mistake. And that is to glaze the inside first, because sometimes this happens. So some things that we can do to clean this up. Thing one is, if it's not a lot of extra glaze, you can come in with a clean paintbrush, and this one's not super clean, which honestly I'm not going to worry about too much just because I've got such a mess on this. But I can come in with a wet paintbrush, I can get the surface wet, wet paper towel, and I can kind of dab stuff off, blend it in, and then come back in with my other glaze on top of it. Something to keep in mind with overglaze is when it melts, it becomes transparent. So you can't just go over a mess like this and expect it to disappear, because when it glaze melts in the kiln, it's going to kind of mix visually with whatever is beneath it and whatever is above it. You can't treat overglaze like you do underglaze. If it mixes or overlaps, you will see it. Okay, so I'm going to see this red. If I really, really didn't want this on here like this, my only solution at this point would be to take this piece over to the sink and wash everything off. I'm not gonna do that. Instead, I'm gonna say, you know what, this is the card that was dealt me. I'm gonna blend this in to the other color, and I'm just gonna see what happens. Because sometimes it's kind of fun to play and experiment and see what glazes do when they layer up with each other. That's what I'm gonna try. And I encourage you to do the same. Layer up two different glazes and see what happens. As long as you're open to whatever happens not being necessarily your ideal situation, try it out. In my advanced sculpture class, our first unit is working with layering glazes and experimenting and seeing what happens. Some of my favorite glazes that my students have done over the years have come from different glazes layered up, which create new and different and interesting effects. So I'm just going to blend this in as I go around my piece. And I might bring a little bit more of that blue on top and blend it back into the glowing embers here.
It's important as artists that we don't let mistakes define us. Instead, we take them and make them into opportunities. Don't let mistakes get you down.
All right, what lesson did we learn here, folks? Let's review this. One, if you are gonna do a poured glaze on the inside of a vessel, and that's what my students do with teapots, do the inside before you do the outside so you can clean up any mistakes. Okay, that's lesson number one. Lesson number two is what Bob Ross preached, man. Happy little accidents. So I made a mess, and instead of freaking out and thinking I ruined my piece, What I did is I went in and I modified what my original plan was, and now maybe I'll have a more interesting piece with a fade from one color to another, or maybe I won't like it, and that's okay. I can always make another thing, or I can just say, oh well, you know what, this piece wasn't my best, no big deal. I'll show you get that one when it's all done. All right, let's talk about glazing something that has texture. So this has quite a bit of texture built in to his kind of furry coating. And if I'm not careful, it's really easy to miss the deeper areas of my clay with my glaze. I've shaken up my glaze. It's a more liquidy one, which looks really nice when you're working with texture, but you really wanna load your brush with quite a bit of glaze, because it's gonna just kind of pour in there. And then you use your brush, you kind of have to jab that glaze into all these different textures. Turn your piece, come at it from different angles, and just take your time to make sure that you're filling all of those textures up with your glaze.
With texture, it's just really important that you're looking at lots of different angles and making sure that every inch of your clay is covered. Get that paintbrush in there, make sure it's fully loaded, and get full coverage.
All right, I've got one coat done. Did you notice how much time I spent kind of turning and looking at different directions? There was a lot of, you know, dabbing and jabbing. So it really, you do want to spend time doing that process. Now I'm going to do my second coat on here. And again, I'm going to keep that brush loaded up with lots of glaze, so I make sure that I'm getting in and around everything I need to get into. I'm going to remember where I started and stopped so that I don't put five coats of glaze somewhere and one coat somewhere else. And I'm just going to take my time and make sure that I get full coverage this time around as well.
Okay, I know I said you're not supposed to glaze the bottom of stuff, but some pieces you need to because of what they are, and what this piece is going to be, it needs to have a glazed bottom. So it's okay to glaze your bottom as long as you or your art teacher has something called a stilt that they can put this up on in their kiln, and you communicate with them that you have a glazed bottom so they can put it in the kiln the right way.
My glaze has set up enough that I can handle my vessels without getting the glaze on my fingers and transferring it. So at this point, I need to clean up the bottom of my vessel so that it doesn't stick to the clay shelf. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna come in with a paintbrush, and I'm gonna get the glaze on the bottom wet and kind of start moving it around. And then I have a sponge that I'm gonna use to go in and lift the glaze off. One of my biggest pet peeves with students sometimes is when they don't take care of the bottoms of their vessels or their sculptures. And what a well-crafted base is looks different depending on what you're doing. If you're making a teapot with me, we glaze the bottom and I put it up on a stilt, but you want it to be neat and clean. If we're making a simple vessel like this or this bowl, we're going to have a clean, unglazed bottom that does not stick to the kiln shelf and does not need to be stilted. And what you don't want to have are random patches of glaze, or when it's sitting on its surface, it needs to look like it's glazed all the way to the bottom. You don't want to see raw clay popping up under your vessel. So you really need to take the time to clean off the bottom of your vessel and make sure that you've got a good, nice finished edge of glaze around the areas on those outer edges. So this one is nice and clean. It's ready to go into the kiln. If you're going between multiple pieces, make sure your hands are clean in between so you don't accidentally get glaze from one piece onto another. And I'm just gonna repeat the same process with this. All right, it's a nice clean base. I've got glaze down to that bottom edge. The base of it is nice and clean. This guy is ready to go into the kiln. Your basic glaze steps for a piece of ceramics. One, rinse and dry off the clay so there's no dust. Two, apply your first coat and let set. Three, apply second and third coats and let set. And remember, if it's a thinner glaze, you're gonna do three coats. If it's a thicker, you do two coats. You do not want too much glaze that it's dripping off. And then four, clean up the base and put it in the kiln to fire. So clean, coat one, coat two, clean up. Here are the outcomes after firing. Two of them I'm happy with, one I'm not, and that's just the way it is sometimes. So this little guy turned out pretty nice. I like how the glaze picked up the texture, gave a bit of richness to the piece. What I'm gonna do is put a post in here, and then this guy's gonna sit in a plant, so it'll be kind of like a plant stake, which I think will be kind of fun for this funky little guy. My Eternal Galaxy, the Crystals Glaze, worked nicely on this vessel. Gives it a little bit of interest, nice deep dark rich color. The bottom fired nice and clean, so I didn't have any issues sticking in the shelf. And then this guy, where I had my little happy accident, maybe the accident wasn't so happy, but you can see that the glaze over here where I spilled, I probably should have wiped more away. It got thick enough that it filled in my texture. The variation between the two layered glazes really didn't play too much together, but you know what? It's really not that bad. This side still looks nice. So in the end, the whole piece isn't ideal, I've still got a pretty nice vessel in the end. Just remember, don't let things get you down. You can always make more stuff. Have some fun, see what happens, play around, and take your time.